In addition to while statements, most computer languages provide support for a for loop as well. You use the for loop with a definite loop, a loop that you know will occur a specific number of times. You'll know exactly how many times the loop will repeat. The for loop statement provides you with three actions in one compact statement. In a for loop declaration statement, it allows a loop control variable to be declared and initialized, evaluated, and altered. Usually the body of a for loop is shorter than a while loop because the altering of the loop control variable happens inside that first line of the for loop versus inside of the body of a while loop. Let's take a look at the for loop structure. Generally, the first component, we have a temporary loop control variable that's initialized to a starting value. This loop control variable only exists inside of our for loop. So after our for loop is completed running, we're not able to access the value inside of that loop control variable. After we've initialized a loop control variable to a starting value, we typically put in the condition that the loop control variable goes up to. So all the loop occurs while the loop control variable does not meet this statement. The final piece of the for loop is how much to increase or decrease the loop control variable each time through the loop. So all three of those pieces go inside of our line, inside of our parentheses for our for loop. And then inside the curly brackets, depending on which language, programming language you're using, will be the statements to execute if the condition or while the condition is true. Here's a simple example. We have a count variable that is declared and initialized to 0. And we're saying while the count goes up to 3, and each time through our loop, we're going to increase count by 1. And we'll output hello, and then once our condition is met, and it becomes false, we'll exit out of our for loop. So this initializes a count variable to 0, checks to see if it's up to 3, and if it's true, we're going to print out hello, and then after we print out hello, we'll stop by our last piece of our for loop and increase our count by 1, and then the evaluation will happen again. Let's take a look at this example where we've set a count variable equal to 0, and we've said specifically we're going to run this loop while count is less than 3, and each time through our loop, we're going to increase count by 1. So the way that I would step through this program is I have a count variable named 0, or set to 0. When 0 is less than 3, so I'm going to output hello. At this point, count is increased by 1, so the count variable now has the value 1 inside of it. I check my evaluation again. 1 is less than 3, so I would go through my for loop again and output hello. Then I'm going to increase count by 1 again, so count is now 2. I will check the condition. 2 is less than 3, so I would output hello again. My third hello is now outputting down in my box to the right. Now I'm going to increase count by 1, so my count value is now 3. 3 is not less than 3, so at this time, that condition turns to false, and I exit out of this for loop, and I print goodbye. Again, here's another example, same simple loop as before, with just the value of count being printed out each time, so that you can see the first time through it is 0, and each time we finish with what's inside of the for loop body, we increase count by 1, reevaluate, and if the condition is true, we go back into our body of our for loop. If it's false, we're exiting out. Let's take a look at a for and a while loop side by side. They all have the same pieces in them. Here is my loop control variable that is declared and initialized to 0. Over here is my loop control variable in my while loop, so it's declared and initialized outside of my while loop. Both statements have a condition to check. Inside my for loop, here's my condition to check that triggers whether I continue on or exit out of my for loop. And in my while loop, here's my condition that I check that determines whether I'm going to continue and exit or continue in the body of the while loop or exit out. Finally, both loops have to have a way to alter the loop control variable. Inside my for loop, it's right up here at the top. Each time through, I'm going to increase my count variable by 1. Inside of my while loop, it is inside of my while loop body. So each time through, after I output hello, then I'm going to increase the count variable before it goes back through and evaluates. So all three, or both these loops, have all three pieces with them. We have a way to declare and initialize the loop control variable, the condition to check, and then a way to alter the loop control variable. Here's a sample of using user input to control how many times the for loop is run. In this case, I'm grabbing the input from the user and storing in a variable called count, and then I'm launching into my for loop, creating a temporary variable called I, setting it equal to 0, and I'm checking to see that I is less than the value that the user put in for count. If it is, then I'm going to output hello, increase I by 1, and then I will perform my check again. If we consider this, that the user put in 3 into count, the first time through, I will be 0, and it will print out, it'll increase I by 1, I will be 1, and it will check to see that I is less than what's in count. So 1 is less than 3, so our for loop will execute again, and we'll have our hello here, it'll output a second time, we'll increase I by 1, so I will now be 2, and it will check that I is less than what the user put in at 3. It is, so we will output hello again, increase I by 1, so I will now be 3. We'll come back up here. 3 is not less than 3, so at this time we'll exit our for loop and we'll continue on down here to print out goodbye. Another way to write the same statement is by counting from higher down to lower. So in this case, we grab our input from our user and we're setting that value to be the initial variable in I. So if we consider that we receive a 3 from the user again, our value inside of I will be 3, and we're going to go and run this loop until I becomes less than 3, or we're going to run this while I is greater than 3. This time, instead of increasing I each time through the loop, we're going to decrease it by 1. If we receive 3 from the user, our initial value inside of I is 3, and we would come down here, we would see that this is a good perp check, so we would output hello. This time we're going to decrease I by 1, so I will now have the value of 2 inside of it. We'll check to see that 2 is greater than 0, and it is, so we'll output hello again, and we'll decrease I by 1, so I will now have the value of 1 in it. 1 is greater than 0, so we'll go down here, we'll output hello one more time, decrease I by 1, which brings our value to 0 in I. And at that time, 0 is not greater than 0, so this condition becomes false, and we exit outside of our for loop, and we print out goodbye. So inside of your for loops, you can count up, or you can count down. You can increase or decrease that loop control variable. For loops are great because you can do it all in one line. You can declare and initialize a loop control variable. You include your condition to check. That has to become false in order to leave the for loop. And then you provide the altering of the loop control variable in the same statement. Although for loops are commonly used to control the execution of a fixed number of times, you don't have to necessarily know the starting or the final or the altering of the loop control variable when the program is written. Those values might be entered by the user, or it could be the result of a calculation, and that's what gives us our flexibility in using for loops.